Good morning, everybody. Welcome to our worship service today. You know, today seems to me like to be a day for giving thanks to those who are serving. Obviously, we just did that for those who are serving in the medical community and how much they deserve our respect, our honor, our thanks, our gratitude. But I also want to thank Brushy Creek this week for a couple of things. Number one, I want to echo Benji's words, thanking you for your generosity and helping us to be a blessing to others. It's just been incredible that we've been able to do so much to help people who are working in disaster-related areas. That's been an amazing blessing. And so thank you for giving. And I want to thank you for your generosity in giving to the church during these very difficult times. So many people have given and have responded, and the giving has been overwhelming, really. And we just want to thank you for that. We don't want to miss an opportunity to say, God bless you for your generosity and for your faithfulness, for your obedience to God's word in giving and staying faithful to the tithe, even though these are uncertain times. And I especially want to thank, too, all the production people that are here today. You know, this doesn't happen without a lot of people. They're pointing us toward cameras. They're back there making sure the sound is right. They're directing us.
They're telling
us to be quiet. Yes, they're doing a lot of things, and they're telling us when to stop and when to start. We appreciate them. We thank you for the hard work that they've done. This just doesn't happen automatically. It doesn't happen magically. It happens when people that are gifted in these areas come out and give their gifts and talents. So just God bless you. I'm just in the mood to say thank you today to everybody. All right, let's take a look at our scripture. Today we're going to be in Matthew chapter 20. We're going to continue talking about and looking at the parables of Jesus. Today we begin in Matthew 20, beginning at verse 1. God's word says, "For the kingdom of heaven is like a landowner who went out early in the morning to hire laborers for his vineyard. And when he had agreed with the laborers for a denarius for the day, he sent them into his vineyard. And he went out about the third hour, and he saw others standing idle in the marketplace. And to those he said, 'You also go into the vineyard, and whatever is right I will give you.' And so they went. Again, he went out about the sixth and the ninth hour and did the same thing. And about the 11th hour, he went out and found others standing around. And he said to them, 'Why have you been standing here idle all day long?' And they said to him, 'Because no one hired us.' And he said to them, 'Will you go into the vineyard too?' When evening came, the owner of the vineyard said to the foreman, 'Call the laborers and pay them their wages, beginning with the last group to the first.' And when those hired about the 11th hour came, each one received a denarius. When those hired the first hour came, they thought that they would receive more, but each of them also received a denarius. And when they received it, they grumbled at the landowner, saying, 'These last men have worked only 1 hour, and you have made them equal to us who have borne the burden and the scorching heat of the day.' But he answered and said to them, 'Friend, I'm doing you no wrong. Did you not agree with me for a denarius? Take what is yours and go. But I wish to give to this last man the same as to you. Is it not lawful for me to do what I wish with what is my own? Or is your eye envious because I am generous? So the last shall be first, and the first last.'" I wonder how many times that you've heard the phrase that serves as the title of this message today. It's not fair. We tend to think of this as being used when we're children. In fact, if you have children under the age of 10, I bet you hear "it's not fair" 2 or 3 times a week, if not 3 or 4 times a day. All you have to do to hear that phrase in your house is to make any move that suggests that you're favoring one child over another, and you're going to hear "it's not fair." But this phrase isn't exclusive to children. In fact, adults often use the fair card a lot of times in their relationships. Sometimes when we run out of anything to say and we're in an argument and we think we're losing, we just pull out the fair card. Yeah, but it's not fair. That phrase has launched 1,000 lawsuits. It's sent a lot of couples into marriage counseling. It's driven a lot of parents right out of their minds. You know, it's the cry of the laborers that were hired first in this passage today. You know, I had an opportunity to play the fair card when I was on staff at Rock Hill Baptist Church in Inman. It was my second place of ministry, and the pastor who was called, he was brand new, he said, look, here's what I'm going to do. I was minister of youth and children at the time. And he said, I'm going to have a minister of youth and children and a minister of education. And because you're here, you get to pick. You can either be the minister of youth or the minister of education. So I decided to be the minister of education because I was thinking in my mind that I wanted to move toward being a pastor. I believe that's what God had called me to do. And so I felt like doing education would get me in that direction. So I picked the education route. Well, the pastor hired a youth minister, and his name was Tony. So we had Tony Bird and Tony Beam working together on staff. And we were working together great. We got along well. We complimented each other until the budget came out. And when the budget came out, I found out that he was being paid a little bit more than me. And that phrase screamed into my brain. It's not fair. I mean, I'd been there 2 years. He was being called by a new pastor and was going to be paid more just because I'd chosen a different route. The choice was up to me. But I thought it wasn't fair that a youth minister would be paid more than me until God pointed me to this passage. And I read it, and I understood its meaning. And I understood that our dependence on the grace of God is absolute. And I want to ask Benji here, what are we really saying? When we say it's not fair, what is it that we're saying about ourselves, about God? What is it?
Well, I think... A lot of times, for many of us, I don't know all of us, but I think for many of us, when we say it's not fair, what we're really saying is, what about me? Like, and we're really trying to make a situation about ourselves. And we're turning this whole thing about, like, hey, this needs to be more about me, not so much about you. Let's make this about me. And I'm often reminded of Rick Warren, his book, The Purpose-Driven Life. And I quote it a lot. It's that first line in the book where he says, it's not about you. And for believers, so much of our life, now that we have died to our old way of living, we're now raised with Christ, it's Him who lives within us, so much of life and our circumstances, they're not about us. They're not about me and trying to figure that out. But I think that's kind of what we're saying, though, a lot of times is when we're saying it's not fair, is we're really going, hey, this, what about me? You know, we're kind of throwing our lip out and pouting.
You know, yeah, that's right. And it's one thing to tell each other it's not fair about a circumstance that we have in our life. It's quite a different story if we say that to God. One of the things that caused the Jews to be carried away into captivity by the Babylonians, part of their rebellious nature, was that an accusation that they would raise against God that He was not treating them fairly. There was a saying, they liked to use this proverb, it was popular among the Jews, the fathers eat the sour grapes, but the children's teeth are set on edge. That's a proverb that questioned God's understanding of justice. Jim, is there ever a reason or a justifying reason for questioning the idea of justice of God?
Well, the short answer to that would be no. And the more involved answer might be, but we will ask the question. And probably all of us either have or will have something in our life where we look back and we think that wasn't right, that wasn't just, and if we don't blame God directly, we blame Him indirectly by saying, why did you let that happen? But the reason that we would ever feel that way is because we don't understand Scripture or we don't understand God's complete purpose in what He allows or what He does. And this morning, our life group was doing our lesson online, and it was out of a Philippians chapter 2, and it says that on that day later that God the Father will cause every knee to bow and every tongue to confess that Jesus is Lord to His glory. And it says that will be everyone above the earth, everyone on the earth, and everyone beneath the earth. And it's interesting to me that there's going to come a day when every single person in heaven or hell will acknowledge the justice of God. I don't know of any place in the Bible that says that anyone that's condemned ultimately will say it wasn't fair. God is just, and the only time He's not just is when He's gracious or merciful.
Listen to the words of Ezekiel 18, chapter 18, verse 2. As I live, declares the Lord God, you're surely not going to use this proverb in Israel anymore, because all souls are mine. The soul of the Father, as well as the soul of the Son, is mine. God goes on to say in verse 25 and 29, yet you say the way of the Lord is not right. Hear now, O house of Israel, is my way not right? Is it not your ways that are not right? You know, when we think about the book of Job, you may remember that most of the book of Job is Job spending time trying to figure out why so many bad things have happened to him. He has a group of friends that shows up that tries to help him figure it out, to discover what has he done to deserve his fate. But when God speaks at the end of the book and he begins to ask Job a series of questions, you know, easy to answer questions like, where were you when the foundations of the earth were laid? How have you commanded the morning since your days began and caused the dawn to know its place? See, God didn't expect Job to have an answer to those kind of questions. God was making a point. God continued his point by asking, shall the one who contends with the Almighty correct him? He who rebukes God, let him answer for it. Can you imagine rebuking God? Can you imagine calling God on the carpet? When God gives Job a chance to get a word in edgewise, here was Job's response. He said, behold, I am vile. What shall I answer you? I lay my hand over my mouth. Once again I've spoken, but I will not answer yes twice, but I will proceed no further. When Job was under fire, when he was listening to his friends, it seemed right to say, it's not fair. But here's the thing. We want to know why, when our response should be who. Not who is responsible, but who is there to help us. Whose love and mercy and grace do we depend on? And is he Almighty God? Is he able to bring all things about to the right place? When we doubt the justice and the fairness of God, we need to understand that we're doing that because of our lack of understanding. We're blessed that God doesn't give us what is fair. We're blessed that God doesn't give us what we deserve, because if he did, we'd be lost forever. What God does do is give us life, love, mercy, grace, and in the end, heaven. Let's take a look at the agreement. If we look at verses 1 through 7, we see that the agreement is sort of laid out. And we'll look at it, first of all, in terms of the call. God calls people to himself. We need to realize that. In fact, without the call of God, we can't come to him. Jesus said these words, if I be lifted up, I will draw all men unto myself. And then Jesus also said this, no one can come to me unless the Father who sent me draws him, and I will raise him up on the last day. That's John 6:44. And the story of the rich young ruler, the parable of the sheep, we see God seeking those who are lost. And in this parable, God is represented as the gracious owner of the vineyard whose grace is important. He goes into the marketplace seeking workers for the field. And when we begin to think that we're more important than our neighbor, or that we're more valuable to God than others, we should remember that we were all standing around in the marketplace. We start out as equals. We're there without hope of providing for ourselves, and yet God calls us to the field. During the time of Jesus, the marketplace was where people went who didn't have steady jobs or consistent incomes. So every day, they were completely dependent on the call of someone who would show up and give them the opportunity to provide for their family. Most of the people in the market were hired early in the day because they wanted to get a full day's wage, and the one doing the hiring wanted to get a full day's work. And so what happens here, when you look at the persistent mercy and the love of God, God not only calls workers in the first hour, but he goes back in the third hour, in the sixth hour, in the ninth hour, even again in the 11th hour, when there's only 1 hour left for the work. And those called in the 11th hour, they stood around all day. They were wondering who's going to meet the needs of their families. They were probably getting ready to go home, dropping their heads in despair, dreading when they'd have to face their wives and children because they didn't have anything to bring to the table. Then suddenly somebody shows up and looks like he's looking for workers. They probably thought, well, it's too late. It's too late for me. I'm never going to be called into the vineyard. I'm never going to get that opportunity today. But no, God says, go into the vineyard, and whatever is right, I will give you. You can see Peter in this. at least I do, dragging his empty net back to the boat for the 100th time. He's been working all night. He hasn't caught anything. Then this carpenter shows up and says, Peter, I want to use your boat to speak a message. And so Peter gladly, since the boat's not being used very well for fishing, he decides, yes, I'll let the carpenter use the boat. So they cast off from the shore. Jesus speaks, and then he turns to Peter and he says, launch out into the deep for a catch. And Peter's got to be thinking, hey, you may be a good speaker, but I'm a fisherman, and I know that we're not going to catch anything, but at your word, I'll drop the net. Peter drops the net, and you know the end of the story. He gets a great catch of fish by the grace of God. We should always, folks, be amazed at the grace of God. He calls again and again and again, all the way up to the 11th hour, right before the accounting is going to take place. You know who was called in the 11th hour? You were. I was. We're Gentiles, called in the 11th hour, grafted into the vine. Hour after hour, the call of God went out to his people, the Jewish people, and yet God began to call the Gentiles, just as in the parable of the Great Supper that we're going to talk about later, and the parable of the wedding feast. We Gentiles were invited by the grace of God to respond to his call. Now, notice the owner of the vineyard. I want to talk about the contract here, the nature of it for a minute, because notice the owner of the vineyard entered into a contract with the workers that he hired. A denarius was a common wage for a Roman soldier, so it would have been a generous wage for workers who were going into the vineyard. But notice there are no contracts for everyone, for anybody except the ones that were called in the first hour. There's just the promise, I will give you what is right. It would have been uncommon for a worker to go into the field without knowing what they're going to be paid. And we don't know, why did it take them so long to get to the marketplace? I mean, we don't know. Maybe they were sidetracked. Maybe they had a physical impediment that slowed them down. Maybe the marketplace was right in the middle of Woodruff Road. I mean, we don't know what caused the workers to be late getting to the marketplace, but we know this. All the workers knew this. They were blessed because they received the call of God to go into the field. Now, when the accounting came, those who didn't have a contract were happy, and those who did have a contract were sad. Those who had a contract spent the whole day looking forward to a denarius, and they're probably looking around at these poor guys that are coming into the field late, going, oh, I'm so thankful I was there in the first hour. I know what I'm going to get. Wonder what these poor guys are going to get. Can I just say this? It is so good that we are dependent on the grace of a holy God. It's good to be dependent on what God is going to give us. We know what the Bible says. The Bible says that we're going to gain heaven, that the mercy of God is going to be ours. But it's good to depend on that grace, to be dependent on Him. I would rather be dependent on God and His grace and His mercy than I would be any kind of a contract. We can all be thankful that God's mercy extends to those who respond to His call. Now, I'm going to ask Benji, when the time came, as we'll see here in a minute, to settle up at the end of the day, those that were hired at the beginning of the day were angry. So when you see that, were they justified? Do you think there's any justification for them to look at the landowner and go, it's not fair?
I think it depends on how you're looking at the story. I think if you're those guys in that story and you're like normal person, you're looking from an earthly standpoint, and you say, you know, 4 + 4 = 8. And then so someone else comes along and 4 + 1 = 8 to them. I think, yeah, they've got a right to be slighted if you're just looking at it from that standpoint. But I think when you're looking at it from a spiritual standpoint, and that's the purpose of the story, is that even those guys who were hired in the beginning, they, you know, everything we receive above and beyond is just grace and mercy. And seeing that the man came and hired them and gave them a job, gave them a work. But I think it just all depends on how you're looking at it, from an earthly standpoint or a spiritual standpoint.
I think that's good. That's very good. Let's look for a second at the challenge that we see in verse 2. Because notice the owner of the vineyard says, when he had agreed with the laborers for a denarius for the day, he sent them into his vineyard. I think that's significant for this reason. He sent them into the field. He didn't have a meeting. He didn't have a seminar. He sent them out to serve directly. What does that mean for us today? It means that we're not just simply called from the marketplace. We're called to the field. We're called to be servants. We're called to fulfill God's call. We're called to live for Him, to honor Him with our lives, to demonstrate our love for Him, to respond to the grace and the mercy that He's poured into us, and to be out fulfilling the call He's placed on us. You know, there's a sense of urgency here. Jesus said in Luke chapter 10, verse 2, "The harvest is truly great, but the laborers are few. Therefore, pray the Lord of the harvest to what? Send out laborers into the field." And so we see that that's exactly what's happening here. In John chapter 9, verse 4, Jesus said this. He emphasized the urgency, saying, "I must work the works of Him who sent me while it is still day. The night is coming when no one can work." So there's the 11th hour. What was the 11th hour? It was the last call, the last opportunity for people to respond to God's grace, because the day will come when God will have an accounting. That is, He will call all things into account. And in that time, then there's not going to be anybody called. It's after the day is spent, after the moment of the opportunity of God's grace has passed, and there comes the opportunity or the moment of God's accounting. And let's look at the accounting. It begins in verse 8. "When evening came, the owner of the vineyard said to his foreman, 'Call the laborers to pay them their wages, beginning with the last group and moving up to the first.'" Now, I'm going to ask Angela, why do you think the landowner reversed the usual order here of the payment when he started with the ones that were hired last instead of first?
Well, I think it's interesting because it's Jesus is telling this parable, and in chapter 19, right before this, he runs into the rich young ruler, and then Peter asks him this question: "What about all of us who have given up everything and are following you?" And Jesus says the same thing. He says the first will be last and the last will be first. And so then he launches into this story. And so I think in a lot of ways it was to show Peter kind of what you were talking about earlier, that yes, I called you as my people early on, but there are going to be more coming behind you. And so then I think it's really neat that in Acts chapter 10, I think it is, that Jesus or God actually uses Peter to share with Cornelius and bring the Gentiles into faith. And so here he's kind of given Peter this whole story about the first and the last, and then he uses Peter in Acts to bring the Gentiles into himself.
Well, it's interesting, Angela, that before that, God had to get a hold of Peter's heart by giving him a vision that caused Peter to understand that the Gentiles were going to be grafted into the vine. Because even Peter had trouble comprehending that or believing that that could happen.
Yeah, and I think it's in like verse 45 or something where it says that all the believers who were there were shocked that God's Holy Spirit would come on even to the Gentiles.
Even the Gentiles, that's right. Praise God, we were part of the call, and that's a demonstration of God's grace. God was demonstrating His grace in the way that He paid the workers. That's the beautiful thing here. When Jesus, the perfect, sinless Son of God, was nailed to the cross because of our sin, God was putting grace on display. When you come up against something in your life that you think isn't fair, when you face a tragedy, when the weight is so heavy that you feel like you can't bear it, God may just be putting His grace on display in your life. You know what the interesting thing is? Those who deserved less were going to get more, and those who deserve more were going to get what they're promised. God is never going to do less for those who were called first. He's demonstrating here His grace for all who were called and responded by going into the field. And I think that's such a beautiful picture. Look at the outrage, though, of the people in verse 11 and 12. Notice it says, when they received it, they grumbled at the landowner. Now, these are the people who were hired first that are now getting their denarius. They've seen what everybody else has got. Now they're getting their pay. And verse 12 saying, these last men have worked only 1 hour, and you have made them equal to us who have borne the burden and the scorching heat of the day. You see, the people didn't understand. The ones who worked all day were mad, not because they were getting less than what they were promised, but because God was being merciful to someone that they thought didn't deserve it. In other words, how dare you, God, treat these people as equals? We've borne the heat of the day. We deserve more. The Greek word that's used here is gozazo, and it's the same word that's used in the Hebrew for murmur. That's the word that they were murmuring against the vineyard owner. Can you see Jonah moping on a hill overlooking Nineveh because God decided to be merciful to the Ninevites? Can you see the prodigal son's brother moping in the back room while everybody else is celebrating because he who is lost has been found? God is showing grace. The father of the prodigal son is showing grace, something that the older brother didn't think that he deserved, because the older brother believed that he had earned God's favor. And there's good news for you today. The good news is we don't earn the favor of God. The favor of God is grace. It's bestowed upon us because of our faith and our belief in Jesus Christ. Yes, our response to that grace should be to respond with obedience and fervor and to serve God in a way that honors Him and glorifies Him. You know, when we get to heaven, I believe we're all going to be in the same place. There's not going to be a heaven for super saints and a heaven for people that just barely get in. We're all going to get in the same way, through the blood, the forgiveness, the grace, our belief and acceptance of Jesus Christ and the power of the Holy Spirit working in us. There's going to be different rewards in heaven for the way that we respond after we come to Christ, but the fact that we're all going to be there is, in a sense, what makes us equal. See, we want people to get what we think they deserved, and the problem is, if that ever happens with God, even those who were called first would be last. I don't know if you heard about this, but Robert F. Smith is a African-American entrepreneur. He's a business owner. He's a multimillionaire. And he was speaking during a commencement speech in front of the Morehouse College graduating class in 2019. Maybe you saw this. Morehouse College is a historically black college or university. And he made the statement. All of a sudden, in the middle of the commencement speech, he said, "My family is going to create a grant to eliminate your student loans." He said, "You great Morehouse men are bound only by the limits of your own conviction and creativity." Now, initially, there was a great response of gratitude, but eventually, people began to say, "It's not fair. What about me? Is my sacrifice?" Parents begin to ask the question, say things like, "We sacrificed, we worked hard, we put money aside, we did all the right things to help our sons and daughters be able to go to college, and yet here we have somebody comes along that offers grace to those who maybe they didn't work quite as hard as we did." See, this is the same thought. It's the eye of envy and instead of the overwhelming grace of God. The good news is this: God doesn't let anybody talk him out of being merciful. Look at verse 15. The landowner asks a good question. He says, "Is your eye evil because I'm good?" And I want to ask Jim this question. What does this passage mean in verse 15 when it says, "Is your eye evil because I'm generous?" Does that relate? Do you see a relationship between with that passage and Saul and David in their relationship?
Well, Saul had a hard time rejoicing with David, and he was an example that it's easier for us to weep with those who weep than to rejoice with those who rejoice. And because we can weep with those who weep because we can feel superior to them, it's harder to rejoice with those who rejoice. And I remember one time counseling with a couple, and he was not a good husband. She was a Christian. He prayed to receive Christ. And her response to that was, "Am I supposed to overlook 10 years of the way he's been because he just prayed a prayer?" And it was the same heart, I think, that's expressed here.
Well, you know, what got Saul started on David, listen to this passage from 1 Samuel 18. Now, understand, when David came back from war, from defeating the Philistines, there were a group of women that began to sing a little song. And that song went something like, Saul has slain his thousands, and David his tens of thousands. Now, just keep that in mind. You got Saul, who's the king, and Saul is hearing more credit being given to David. 1 Samuel says, "Then Saul was very angry at the saying. It displeased him, and he said, 'They have ascribed to David 10,000s, and to me they've ascribed only thousands. Now, what more can he have but the kingdom?'" Now, listen to this last statement. "So Saul eyed David from that day forward." Did you get that? He eyed David. What is that? The eye of envy, and it destroyed him. Saul was afraid of what David was getting compared to what he was getting. And a lot of time we're afraid that we're going to be underappreciated while someone else is overappreciated. Our only concern should be this: the overarching grace and mercy of a loving Father who never gives us what we deserve, but gives us, out of his love and abundance, mercy. The last will be first, and the first last, because of the way God has chosen to demonstrate his grace. Now, I want to ask, you think, Angela, there's a parallel too here about the outrage of the first worker's response and Jonah and Nineveh, and we talked a little bit about it. I talked about that. Is that, you think that's valid, that those were similar?
Yeah, definitely, and we can see it in lots of ways in Saul and David and Jonah and Nineveh, but we see it in our own life, too. I remember back during 9/11, it was really hard at times to pray for those terrorists to come to know the Lord because we had deemed them our enemies, and we wanted them to get what was coming to them. And so I think we do that in our own life all the time, where on a earthly field, we make people our enemies. And I think it just shows that we've lost a sense of who we are and who God is. You know, when the woman comes and washes Jesus' feet with her tears, and Jesus says, those who've been forgiven much will love much. I think sometimes we forget that we've been forgiven much, and it causes us not to love the people around us.
Amen. I think that's true. Some of the things that I want us to take away from today: every believer who's born again will have room in the Father's house that's been prepared by the Son. Every believer is part of the body of Christ, which is his bride. Every believer is a child of God and a fellow heir with Jesus Christ. Every believer is blessed with every spiritual blessing in the heavenly places. That's what Paul tells us in Ephesians. God initiates and accomplishes salvation. He is merciful, and he continues to call even unto the 11th hour. He's compassionate, and he fills those who come to him that are admitting their need. God expects everyone who is called to join him in his work, and God keeps his promises. Now, I want to conclude by thinking for just a minute about the repentant thief on the cross. If ever there was an 11th hour moment, this is it. He was getting what he deserved in this life. He was a convicted thief who realized too late in this life that he couldn't blame his circumstances on anyone else. He was the cause of his own problems. And when he heard the other thief railing against Jesus, he responded by saying this: "Do you not even fear God, seeing you're under the same condemnation? And listen to this: we indeed justly, for we receive the due reward for our deeds, but this man has done nothing wrong." And then he looked at Jesus and he said, "Lord, remember me when you come into your kingdom." Jesus didn't hesitate. He said, "Today you will be with me in paradise." Suddenly, in the 11th hour of his life, here's a man who was getting what he deserved, and in an instant he got something he couldn't have imagined. He received grace from God. He began to acknowledge his responsibility for his sin. He acknowledged the sinless nature of Jesus, and then he counted on Jesus for hope beyond the grave. And if we do that, we'll be born again. If we do what this thief on the cross, it's almost like a picture of repentance. Acknowledge that we deserve where we are in life. then turn to Jesus, who is the sinless Savior. Acknowledge who Jesus is, the Son of God, the only one who can make a difference in our life. And then ask Him to make us ready to join Him in heaven. That's what salvation. When we confess our sin, He is faithful and just to forgive us of our sin and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. God will make us right. He'll make us clean. But we have to come to Him broken, not full of ourselves, empty, so that He can fill us with His grace and His mercy and bestow forgiveness on us. Have you received God's grace? Listen, you may think it's too late for you. I talk to people all the time, and one of the things, if they don't know Jesus, they'll say to me, "Preacher, you don't know my life. You don't know what I've done. You don't know how far I've drifted. You don't know how I treated this person." And you know what? It's not necessary that I know, because God knows all those things, and He calls us by His mercy and His grace, even in the 11th hour. There you stand in the marketplace of this world, wondering how you're going to make it through another day. Jesus is right there in this moment, in these circumstances, in the difficulty of this day, calling you to respond, calling you to the field, calling you to forgiveness, redemption, and eternal life in heaven. Would you respond to Him today? How will you respond? I want you to think about that while we listen to our praise band play again, and I want us to pray together first. Father, I pray in these moments that as this word has gone forth, You've promised us that it will never return void. I pray for those who are hearing this message today that maybe they think that the 11th hour has come and gone for them. But Lord, we know that as long as this world endures, we still have an opportunity to respond to Your grace. That You're standing there today calling people, calling them out of the marketplace, calling them into the field, calling them into Your grace, into Your mercy. You're calling them to have a place in heaven. I pray that there'll be those in this moment who will answer that call and who will respond to the gospel. In Jesus' name. Amen.
I worship You, I worship You. You are here, working in this place. I worship You, I worship You. You are here, moving in our midst. I worship You. don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop working. You never stop working. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop working. I worship you. You are here working in this place. I worship you. I worship you.
Praise the Lord. What a wonderful way to end our service today with that particular song, God is here. That's the message that is in this parable. God is here, His grace, His mercy. He's in the marketplace. He's where we are, calling us to have a relationship with Him. If you responded today, I think we can put a number up on the screen where you can call and let us know, or text and let us know that you responded today to the message. Maybe you prayed and invited Jesus into your heart. Maybe you had a special need that you prayed for today because something about the message that you heard called out to you in a way that caused you to call out to God. If that's true, we want to pray with you. We want to encourage you, particularly if you ask Jesus into your heart today. We want to know because we want to encourage you further and get some information to you. So if you could text us, you can send us a message, please reach out to us. And I just want to thank you again and let everybody know we love you. The staff and the church is doing fine. I mean, you saw the ministry opportunities that we've been taking advantage of. We're going to continue to do that. Again, please, if you have a need, we stand ready to meet it. And we're praying for you every day. There's a possibility the governor is going to change some of the restrictions next week. We don't know how that's going to go. But however, whenever the transition comes, that we begin to move back toward a more understanding of life that we had before, whenever that comes, or if it's sooner or later, know this, that God is going to be with us, and we're going to be praying, and we're going to be looking after each other in a consistent way. Thank you for joining us today. Let's pray. Lord, we're so thankful for those who led in worship today. We're thankful, God, for the message that has gone out. Speak to our hearts, Lord, and take the word, take the comfort that we know that you're with us in the marketplace, calling us into the field to be your servants. And by your grace, Lord, that's how we are called. Thank you for that. We pray for your grace and mercy to continually pour into our lives as we go forward. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless you. Have a good week.